Our subject, much better. Okay, memory, what can you do? Right? We all want to grow old. We want to grow old well. We want to see our kids prosper, our grandchildren, our great-grandchildren. How many here have great-grandchildren? Wow, look at that. Wow. I have two married children, ages 30 and 34. I have no grandchildren but one grand dog. That's as close as we've gotten so far. I don't know what's wrong with these kids, but before I introduce our speaker, I am going to just take a moment to highlight the Lennar Foundation Medical Center, the new beautiful building on Ponce that you may have driven by on your way here. It will be opening on December 5th. Okay, that's very close by. I remember about 2 years or so ago at the ceremonial groundbreaking, which I was the MC of, and I said, we will open in December of 2016. And Stuart Miller, our chair at the time, who knows something about buildings and homes and things like that, said, yeah, sure. And I said, no, we really will. And we are opening on December 5th, 2016. Most of what you need to go downtown for today, you'll be able to do there. Okay, not all, but most. It's an outpatient facility. It's four stories, a little over 200,000 square feet. All kinds of imaging equipment, radiation oncology, chemotherapy, all of the Sylvester services, really. There'll be six operating rooms for outpatient surgery. It's a 23-hour facility. There's not overnight stays there. It's just ambulatory care. Bascom Palmer will be there. Men's health, women's health, sports medicine, physical therapy, and then our specialist, and we're still working through, and this will really have to do with the demand over time, which specialties are there and how often they're there. Some will be there 5 days a week with multiple people, some will be there less often, and we'll work that out as time goes along. But now, if you're scheduling a doctor's appointment for sometime post December 5th, you may be scheduled for the Lennar Foundation Medical Center. We've got dozens, maybe low hundreds of employees that are there right now preparing for the first patients who arrive. I have a very brief video. This is 90 seconds that we're going to run. It features Ben Riestra, who is the chief administrative officer and the person who's been charged with opening this facility.
It started with the idea that no two humans are alike. Inspired by human imagination, the University of Miami Health System is set to revolutionize the way healthcare is delivered. We've created a unique place that provides personalized services that awaken the senses and inspire individuality, where the patient experience is intuitively transformed into a journey of being well. At the Lennar Foundation Medical Center, world-class academic health experts from UHealth will join physician scientists from Sylvester Comprehensive Cancer Center, Bascom Palmer Eye Institute, and University of Miami Health System Sports Medicine Institute. Every day, they will bring together leading-edge technology, groundbreaking clinical trials, and innovative treatments to reveal human excellence. At the University of Miami Health System, we believe in treating people as human beings. We will know you personally, care for you individually, and guide you uniquely. This is not just about a new building. More importantly, it's a new destination, a new experience. A new way of being well. Consider the possibility of feeling human again.
So our goal with this facility is to not only have the very best of what UHealth has to offer, but to also have a patient, to provide you with a patient experience that you feel good about from the moment you do valet parking, or you park in the Ponce garage and you walk through an air-conditioned covered walkway into the building. The kids from the Frost School of Music may be playing their instruments when you walk in. If you go up to a higher floor, you'll be able to watch football practice. Although Mark Rick wants us to put in very tall palm trees so that if you are a fan of the opposing team, you won't be able to do that quite so easily. But it will be very special. You might mark your calendars on January 29th. So this is a couple of months away. But January 29th from 1 to 4 p.m., there will be an open house for anyone who wants to come and walk through and so forth. So you'll hear more about that and there'll be other notifications. So before I introduce Dr. Crocco, since I have the microphone, I'm gonna share my own experience. I bet you everybody in this room has an experience that they can share with respect to memory loss and aging well and so forth. And so here's mine. You know, I've been at the University of Miami for 10 years. Before that, I was in the newspaper business for 30 years. I was the president of the Miami Herald for a long time, and then I followed Knight Ritter out to San Jose, where I was the publisher of the Mercury News, and then moved to Philadelphia as the publisher of the Inquirer and the Daily News. On January 1 of 2004, left my family, kids were still in school back in San Jose. My dad, who was born in 1924, living in Miami, right, came up to spend a few days with me in Philadelphia. First time he and I had spent, you know, several days together, just the two of us, in a very long time. You know, so he would have been what? So that was, this was 2004, 70 years old at the time, right? 80 years old. 80 years old. 80 years old. He seemed pretty good, right? Not perfect, pretty good. And we had a wonderful time. And he went back to Miami, and I remember about 2 months later, he called me. And sort of fighting through the tears, said, "Joe, I've been diagnosed with Alzheimer's disease. I can't balance the checkbook. I can't balance my checkbook anymore." And he was an accountant, you know. He was a smart man. He was a very smart man, World War II vet, well-read. And I didn't know what to say. You know, I was so very unprepared, not very knowledgeable. And I said, "Dad, what are you going to do? What are you going to do? You've had a great, you know, you've had a great life, and it's not over. And, you know, we'll all do the best we can." But I was terribly unprepared for that call, you know? And my dad died 2 years ago. So he lived with Alzheimer's disease for 10 years. And I can tell you all sorts of stories about those 10 years. I moved back from Philadelphia to Miami, not just because of that, but in part because of that. And over that decade, I've learned so much about, you know, what the person who has the disease experiences and the responsibilities on the caregivers, which are enormous. I'm sure many people in this room have experienced this, and it's really something. And so, you know, you are really doing the right thing by being here today, because I think knowledge is power, and that's really what a session like today is about. And so with that, I'm going to introduce you to our very special guest speaker. Dr. Elizabeth Crocco is one of the country's experts on the intricacies of aging and memory and how we can make the best of our golden years. She has a very long title, longer than my title, because she is, in fact, very, very distinguished. So she is the medical director for the University of Miami Memory Disorder Clinic and chief of the Division of Geriatric Psychiatry. She also holds a position as associate clinical professor for the Department of Psychiatry and Behavioral Sciences at the Miller School of Medicine and UM. And just to give you a little bit of insight into her, to get to know her a little bit as a person, she's been at the university for 18 years. She's been in South Florida for about 20 years, born in New York City, big reader. I said, "What do you read?" She says, "I read everything." I said, "Can you give me some examples?" So, most recently, she read The Excellent Lombards by Jane Hamilton, Miss Peregrine's Home for Peculiar Children by Ransom Riggs, American Pastoral by Philip Roth, and American Psychosis by E. Fuller Torrey. So I don't know how she finds time to do all that reading, I don't know. Tomorrow she's gonna go see Nobel Prize winner Bob Dylan, right, tomorrow? And she tries never to miss Broadway Across America, the Florida Grand Opry, and ice hockey games, which feature her her son, who's the goalie in the South Florida Scholastic League. Favorite thing about living in South Florida is living near the beach with a view of the intercoastal in the coolest place around, but not the coldest place around. In her youth, she acted off-Broadway in high school, was paid $35 per performance. So she doesn't mind that we only compensate her modestly at the University of Miami, right? She is a tremendous asset to the University of Miami and to this community. There's no one who is more knowledgeable than she is. She's a great resource for all of us. And so it's my great pleasure to introduce you to Elizabeth Crocco.
Hi. Well, I can't tell you, it's an absolute privilege and honor to be here. I am absolutely flabbergasted by the outpouring of people that are here. And I want to do this justice, and I really hope that you learn something today and that you take part in some of the memory screenings that we have, and we'll talk about that. So the title of my talk today is Memory, What Can You Do? The reason that I just want to give a small shout out to Dr. Dolores Perdomo. Where are you, Dolores? So she was the one about weeks ago who came up with the idea, because it is Alzheimer's Disease Month. You know, it's Alzheimer's Month in November, for me to give a talk down here. And it just happens to coincide with today. I wrote an article in the Miami Herald on Alzheimer's disease that was published today. So if you get a chance to go online, if you get the Herald, you can read that brief article. So I wanted to talk today about memory disorders, mainly Alzheimer's disease. And without further ado, I'm going to go through my slides. So I just put this is a disclosure slide that talks about the grant support, the clinical research support that I get, and some of the honoraria that I receive outside the university for my lectures that I give in continuing medical education. So I wanted to cover a lot of topics today because I think there's a lot of important things I want to share with you about memory disorders, about memory and aging, about the Memory Disorder Center and what we do in the University of Miami. So to give you an overview, I am going to talk about aging and cognitive aging and how is that different than cognitive disorders like Alzheimer's disease. I want to talk to you about what are the risks or the predictors of risks in the development of Alzheimer's disease and other dementias. I want to give you an overview of the Memory Disorder Clinic and all the things we do there, which is not just diagnosing, but management and helping and doing research as well as teaching. I want to talk to you about management of cognitive disorders in general, and then a lot of the awesome research that I'm hoping to reach out to some of you to take part in the University of Miami. So this is a...
Is it available online so we don't have to take notes?
That's a good question that I don't know the answer, but I'm sure we can make it available to you. Yeah, I'll try to remember to do that, no problem. So this slide, this is a slide on the aging population. Anybody who's anybody in geriatrics or aging knows this slide. Here in the United States, with the advent of the baby, we're living longer. Baby boomers are reaching the senior citizen age of 65. And over the next 50 years, we're really going to skyrocket the number of persons in the United States over 65 and even over 85, okay, as we're living longer and longer, which is a good thing, except that when it comes to diseases such as Alzheimer's disease, the greatest risk factor is aging. And so we're going to see a future epidemic of Alzheimer's disease, both in this country and worldwide. Whereas if you look at this graph in 2015, it says worldwide we have about 35 million people with Alzheimer's. By 2050, that's going to skyrocket to close to 110 million. Which is a lot. And you know, when I give lectures all the time to young people, medical students, residents, about dementias and Alzheimer's disease. And one of the things I tell them is, you know, and this is gonna be my only political statement today. You know, we have a lot of fears in this country, you know, about ISIS and the Middle East. But the reality is that this is what's going to break us, is the fact that we have an absolute epidemic of persons having Alzheimer's disease coming our way, and we still don't have a cure. And most of these patients, you know, are being taken care of by caregivers with very little support. This is a big problem that we have in this country, a huge one. And hopefully we're going to come up with a solution for it. So one of the things that has occurred recently when it comes to looking at dementia and Alzheimer's disease, particularly in this country, is it's being recognized that we need to look at early detection of those individuals who are the greatest risk to develop Alzheimer's disease as a priority, to recognize them clinically and to teach physicians how to recognize them and healthcare providers. And as we recognize it, to be able to look that this is the time where maybe we can slow the progression significantly and maybe even come up with cures. So I want to talk to you about normal aging, okay? What is normal cognitive aging? Things happen when you age. You know, I'm going to be 50 next year, and I feel, I joke all the time, I forget words, I get forgetful, I say, this is a problem. What happens as you age? Well, we slow down. We slow down motorically. We are not able to learn new materials as fast and as efficiently as we used to be able to. We're unable to perform very complex tasks, and we can't pay attention as well. But there are many things that get better as we age. Our wisdom, our language abilities typically get better. We have a larger language base, and our judgment can be, we're not as impulsive. So when I look at this slide and I look at what happens to elderly, I'm reminded of my son who's 17 and driving, and I joke with my husband about this that, you know, thank goodness he hasn't been in any accidents, because he certainly drives much more impulsively than we do, but he tends to have much better reflexes than we do because he's quicker and he's able to pay attention better. The other thing I want to point out about this that I tell young people love video games. You know, they love these especially these violent video games with the shooting, those first-person shooters. The reality is research has shown that those violent video games actually improve many of these cognitive skills that are lacking in people as they age normally. And there are actually researchers out there that want to try and get elderly patients to play these crazy video games rather than Luminosity or doing the crossword or other but of course, what do you think the elderly, older people say? They say, get the heck out of here, I don't want to do that. But as you can see from these normal cognitive aging, these are some things that you may recognize, as you're getting older. So those are normal things. What is not normal? Well, dementia is not normal. This is a disease process. It's not a part of normal aging, and it causes significant cognitive dysfunction. It can also cause other symptoms, neurological symptoms, psychiatric symptoms, and functional problems with day-to-day tasks. And where you can have dementia or cognitive disease at a young age, you think of somebody who has had a head trauma. What's big in the news now is, kids who play football, people who play football and having head trauma, developing dementia. But dementia is most commonly seen in people over 50. And it can have many, many different causes. So the DSM-5, which is the Diagnostic and Statistic Manual, you may have heard of it. This is kind of like what the Bible of psychiatry, where they list all of the symptomatology for different psychiatric conditions, such as major depression, schizophrenia, attention deficit disorder. It was newly published in 2013, the DSM-5. The DSM-4 hadn't been changed in close to 20 years when I was a resident. And if you look at the DSM-5, there is no chapter that has undergone more change. They completely revamped it than the chapter that talks about dementias and cognitive disorders. And there are two reasons for that. One reason is because we've learned in the last 20 years so many things about neurodegenerative changes from things like Alzheimer's disease. And the second reason is that we now recognize when people get this disease that they may not be demented, but they may be having some subtle cognitive changes that put them at risk to the disease process that we're recognizing. And then I just put the definition up here. Major neurocognitive, they did away with the terminology dementia. And the reason they did away with that term is because it's too limiting, and everybody thinks of Alzheimer's disease when there could be other causes. But we still use that term because it's just so incorporated in our culture that everybody knows what the word dementia uses. But now they call it major neurocognitive disorders. It shows significant cognitive decline from a previous level. So that's the key to somebody having a dementia or major neurocognitive disorder. There's a change from before. And it's significant in one or more cognitive domains. There's usually concern from the family member, from the loved one, or the patient themselves. And it's through clinical assessment we find that there's impairment, and it causes them interference with something called their IADLs, their instrumental activities of daily living. And those are the things that we all do on a day-to-day basis that we need brain power to do. Cooking, driving, remembering our appointments, right? Remembering to take our medications, cleaning the house, paying our bills, okay? And so there's impairment in those realms that's not related to something physically wrong with them. It's more of a brain problem. And then the type of problem. So when you look at the most common forms of dementia, this list looks at the big four that we see in people over 50 that are by far the most common. Alzheimer's disease, definitely the most common at 60-80%. You know, when somebody has significant dementia at an age that is greater than 65, this is the most common illness that they're having. But it could also be vascular disease, such as strokes or multi-infarct dementia, we call it. You may have heard this term, Lewy body disease, or diffuse Lewy body disease, which is a sort of like Parkinson's disease. Maybe you've heard Robin Williams, the poor man who committed suicide, the actor and comedian. On autopsy, he was found to have Lewy body. So there was quite a bit of press on this, but it's quite common. Some say up to 30% of cases of elderly persons who have dementia. And then frontotemporal dementia rounds it out at 5%. But the take-home message I want from this slide is that even though we physicians, when somebody has dementia, when somebody has a major neurocognitive disorder, we try to rule out medical causes that are reversible. But unfortunately, the reality is when you're older and when you meet that criteria for major neurocognitive disorder, the chance of it being reversible is tiny. It's usually a neurocognitive disorder. It's less than 1%, okay? Unfortunately. So I just want to talk for the next two slides a little bit about this disease, Alzheimer's disease. What is it? Well, the most prominent symptom that most people know about is memory loss, okay? But a lot of people don't, and that's a layman's term for memory loss. But a lot of people don't quite understand what memory loss is. So I may say to a loved one, you know, is your husband having memory loss? Is there a problem with his memory? And the wife may say to me, well, no, his memory is 10 times better than mine. He can remember things from 50 years ago that I have completely forgotten about. Well, that's not really the type of memory loss we're talking about when we talk about diseases like Alzheimer's disease. We're really more talking about the ability to lay down new memories and to learn, right? So it's more that day-to-day memory loss, forgetting, you know, forgetting to remember things. Why did that? Those are the type of problems that we see in Alzheimer's disease. This illness is very slow and insidious. Typically, from the time of diagnosis to death is 11 years. And as the disease progresses, you start to see other cognitive domains become affected, such as their ability to name things in language, carry out complex tasks in their day-to-day ability, their orientation to time and where they are. They may become disoriented. And later, they may develop behavioral problems, which can often, I'm going to talk on this in a little bit, which often can be the most disabling and troublesome for any loved one trying to take care of someone with Alzheimer's disease. I just want to mention, we do have treatment regimens. We do have pharmacotherapies for Alzheimer's disease. It's important that you understand, and they are FDA indicated. The two available treatments that we have are things called cholinesterase inhibitors and NMDA antagonists, okay? So cholinesterase inhibitors, they started with this drug called Tacrin. That's not, we don't use that often because you had to give it five times a day and it caused a lot of liver problems. That was back 20 years ago. That came on the market when I was a resident. And now we've developed other drugs such as donepezil or Aricept, rivastigmine, and galantamine, which, you know, if you ever watch TV, you'll see commercials for these drugs. And they're indicated for mild, moderate, and severe Alzheimer's. NMDA antagonists such as memantine, which is also known as Namenda, you may see advertised. That's more for people who have more severe Alzheimer's disease. So without going into great detail, what do these drugs actually do? Well, what they do is they don't cure the disease. They moderately help at best, okay? And what that means is they can help improve the cognition a little bit. They can help prevent behavioral problems for a time, and they can help delay the progression for a period of time, a year, 2 years, 3 years. So they're not a cure, and they only help moderately. So it's very important when we prescribe these medicines that we look at our risk-benefit profile to make sure that they're not having terrible side effects and that they can tolerate these drugs. So, other pharmacological approaches in the 20 years I've been in the field, and we can run through them, antioxidants such as vitamin B, vitamin E, I'm sure if you're knowledgeable, you may have read about these things, non-steroidal anti-inflammatory agents, hormonal therapies such as estrogen replacement, medical foods or foods that improve mid-chain fatty acids. These have all been looked at, and unfortunately, none of them have really demonstrated, once you have dementia, to make any significant dent in delaying the progression of the disease. So a shift has been made looking at drugs and pharmacotherapy that's meant to get rid of the bad proteins in a person's brain that's thought to be the major cause of disease like Alzheimer's disease. One of those proteins is amyloid or beta amyloid, and the other is tau. So I listed here, these are techniques that are used, that have been used and have been studied primarily in mouse models and in animal models that have shown a lot of success in reducing amyloid in the brain through immunization, through reduction and enzyme inhibition. So it works great in models, but many of these drugs have been looked at in patients who already have dementia, and none of them have been that good. And over the last 15 years, none of them have really shown enough promise once you have dementia, right, to slow the progression. And this has been really not good. This is not good for the, for, for us researchers and us people who are trying to come up with a cure. Okay? So a large shift in the last 20 years, a big shift have been, we need to diagnose this disease process a little bit earlier. We need to look at patients who we know that this disease starts probably many, many years before the person has dementia or a major neurocognitive. So we need to recognize those people who are at greatest risk to develop this disease when they're first just starting to have problems. And so the term mild cognitive impairment came around about 20, 25 years ago, with this concept being that these are people who, it's also called minor neurocognitive disorder in the DSM-5, that these are people who will eventually, some of them, develop Alzheimer's disease because they have to start somewhere having cognitive problems before they're demented, okay? And the definition for the last 20, 25 years is very simple. The person has a memory complaint, or the loved one, the caregiver. This person's memory, there's a problem. They're not as good as it was before, okay? But they're normal, they're not demented, they can take care of all their IADLs, they can cook, remember their appointments, drive, do everything normally. But when we test them, they're not quite as good as we would expect for their age. That is mild cognitive impairment, okay? Very simple. So this kind of change completely changed the ballgame. It completely changed the way we conceptualize who's going to develop early Alzheimer's disease. Because in the old days, if you go to your physician, and you say, you know, you're over 65, you say, you know, I'm worried about my memory. Is this normal aging, or is this really something I should be worried about? My mother had Alzheimer's disease, and I'm worried I got Alzheimer's disease. And you go to your physician, and so the physician takes a history and maybe asks you a few memory questions, asks you a few screening, and you don't do so bad. And he says, oh, you're fine, right? That's not how it works anymore, unfortunately. Because one of the things that I do as an expert in the Center on Aging and the Memory Disorder is we want to look at who are those people that I can say, you're fine, you're normal. This is normal aging versus you've got issues here that is not normal aging. You are at a risk to develop Alzheimer's. So we need to do something about this, okay? So MCI can gradually progress into a neurocognitive disorder, such as all those things I talk about, Alzheimer's disease, the Lewy body, frontotemporal and vascular dementia, and the rate of progression is 12 to 15% a year they develop Alzheimer's, which is a lot. However, not everybody who has mild cognitive impairment goes on to develop dementia. So this is the place where you really want to see a physician, an expert, and take those steps for intervention. Okay, and I'm going to talk a little bit about that clinically, and I'm going to talk a little bit about that research-wise and what we do. At the University of Miami Center on Aging, myself and my colleagues, Dr. David Lowenstein and Dr. Rosie Curiel, unfortunately they're not here today, Dr. Lowenstein came up with this concept, well, if the MCI patients, a large number at 15% a year, go on to develop Alzheimer's disease, well, maybe we could even see there's a pre-MCI state, whereas we can even earlier on look at those people at great risk and intervene. So he coined the term pre-MCI, okay? Yes, ma'am?
Is Alzheimer's inherited?
Yes, and I'm gonna go through it. I'm gonna go through that. With the idea being, what if you have a very, very astute, well-seasoned clinician in cognition, and they don't meet criteria for MCI, but we really believe that there's something not quite right, this isn't normal aging. Or we found something on cognitive testing that suggests that there's something wrong, and they're at great risk. We found that in these pre-MCI subtests, they had a 6 to 7-fold risk of progressing to a formal diagnosis of MCI or dementia over a 2 to 3 year period, okay? So when you have a memory complaint, or your loved one has a memory complaint, say, you know, sometimes it's normal aging, but sometimes it's a harbinger for something worse, right? And so it's important to have it diagnosed and looked at early on. We have a study ongoing. We're in year 2. We call it the DETECT-PAD study. It's early detection of Alzheimer's. It's a 5-year study in which it's a naturalistic study where we examine people over 63 years of age. We have now recruited over 250 subjects in this study, because what we're doing is we're looking at, we develop cognitive tests that are so subtle that they can easily pick up in patients who have the most subtlest finding, those that are more a greater risk to develop disease processes like Alzheimer's disease, which is going to become more and more important. Because one of the things I teach many, many, many clinicians in the community about Alzheimer's disease and how to treat it. And unfortunately, and this is another problem that we have, unfortunately, we know a lot about heart health. We know how to prevent stroke. Everybody knows the correct diet, that we need to exercise, that we need to lower cholesterol. Our doctors, no smoking, control our diabetes. Every single layperson knows this, right? It's been well educated. Every physician tells you to do this, good for your heart. But it's very rare that we, as lay people, and even our own physicians, know about cognitive health. They don't know. They don't know any of this. And so this is one of the things we're trying to promote, because we believe the earliest you diagnosis is when the intervention is going to occur, not when you're already demented. So this is a study that we have 250 people enrolled. It's a 5-year study, naturalistic study. We look at MRIs, lumbar punctures. We look at cerebral spinal fluid in these patients. And we're looking at people who come in who are normal that have a memory complaint. And we follow them over time. We want to see who's at the risk to develop Alzheimer's. But just as important, we want to know who are those people, they coined the term the super agers. Who are those people that may have a memory problem, but they don't go on to develop Alzheimer's disease. They're completely normal. We kind of want to know what's special about them, too. So this is an ongoing study that we're still recruiting in. So what are the predictors? If you have memory loss and you go to the seasoned clinician, and the seasoned clinician said, well, I think your memory's a little worse than it should be for someone your age. Who are those people that go on to develop diseases like Alzheimer's disease? Well, if they have, obviously, if they're more severely cognitively impaired, those ones are at greater risks. If they have on their MRI, okay, when you do an MRI, if they have more medial temporal atrophy, that means shrinkage of the brain in the medial temporal lobes, and white matter disease. Those are just fancy terms for small vessel changes, usually due to arterial sclerotic plaques that commonly occur in elderly, even though they're asymptomatic. If they have a severity of hypometabolism on PET imaging, that's called positron emission, which is a form of, functional MRI, extrapyramidal signs and symptoms, vascular risk factors, so if you have diabetes, hypertension, those are patients that are much more at risk, high levels of tau in the CSF, APOE4 carrier status, psychiatric illness. So these are all combination of different risk factors that usually in a specialty clinic, we tend to look at least some of these to see who's at greater risk and who we need to help. So I'm going to go through a few of these things. So this is your brain, and this is a cross-section of an MRI. It's called a coronal section. It's like if somebody took a slice right through your head like this and showed right in the middle of your brain. And on the left is a fairly normal brain, and on the right, as you can see, there's a lot of shrinkage of the brain tissue. And if you can see where this circled in red on both sides, that's where your hippocampus is. That's called the medial temporal lobe. And you can see on the right side that that's very much shrunk. And that's typically what you will see in somebody who's at high risk or already has Alzheimer's disease. So this is one way we look at high-risk people. Beta amyloid imaging. We now have the technique and the ability to inject radio-labeled materials into your body to measure how much beta amyloid, or that bad protein that patients with Alzheimer's disease have, and how much is in your brain. We actually have this technique and we're able to do this. Again, the more beta amyloid, and it's, as you can see on the right, it lights up red, as opposed to the image on the left, where it's much more blue and it's not as bright. We have blood markers. We have markers, genetic markers in your blood that we can look at, and this is where the genetic factor comes in, that there are certain blood markers, they're called APOE4 status, that if you have one APOE4 gene, you're at a 4 times risk of developing Alzheimer with a primary relative like a mother, a father, a brother, a sister. And if you have both genes, you're at a 10-time risk of developing Alzheimer's disease. So these are all factors that if you have early memory loss, that we will be worried about you, that you're most likely to develop Alzheimer's disease. And then finally, we have lots of biomarkers in the cerebral spinal fluid by doing a spinal tap or an LP, looking at bad proteins such as tau, phosphorylated tau, and A-beta, which is a form of amyloid, okay? So the reason I'm going through all this, all of those tests that I just went through, it is not typically done by physicians. Okay, so your primary care, your cardiologist, even most neurologists don't do all those testing early on to see who is at the greatest risks. One reason is because we don't educate people as well about cognitive health, and a lot of these advances are newer. But a big reason why we don't do it is because they're expensive and Medicare doesn't cover them. So up on this slide, there's actually a study ongoing of which I am involved in at the Memory Disorder Center, where the Alzheimer's Association, who's a great advocate for helping people with Alzheimer's disease, and the American College of Radiology, we're undergoing a 4-year trial where we clinically are doing these amyloid imaging scale on people who have very early memory changes to see if it helps us to diagnose it in the long run. And if Medicare and CMS sees that this is worthwhile, hopefully they're going to be able to pay it with a reasonable copay, which is going to be very important for the future, very important for the future. So that's another study we have.
Can you back up just 1 second?
Sure.
When you shared the first scan where you saw the actual shrinkage,
yes. Yes.
Okay.
You can, yes. Yeah. So she was asking, can you already see that shrinkage of the brain, like on the right in the MRI, in patients that don't have the cognitive problems yet? Sometimes, yes. Yes, sir. No. So he's asking two things. He's asking, with all these tests that I'm showing, is there not one prototypical test that really is the end-all, be-all diagnosis of Alzheimer's, that makes the diagnosis of Alzheimer's? And these people who sell these kits testing genetic factors, is that really useful? So to the second question, no, it's not useful, particularly without counseling from a geneticist or a specialist who's going through the whole, because not everybody who has APOE4 positive homozygous, even though that you're 10-time increased risk, of developing Alzheimer's, and not everybody gets it, even if they have that status. So it's not thought of as important unless they're having symptoms. Well, it's not thought of as productive unless they're having symptoms. And to the answer to the first question, no, there is no prototypical test. And many of these tests are very expensive. We would like Medicare to pay for some of them, but that's one of the reasons why we at the University of Miami are developing neurocognitive tests to develop Alzheimer's earlier and earlier, because they're a fraction of the cost and they're just as effective. Okay?
What is the progression from senior moment?
Hold on, yeah. So let me finish, because some of these questions I'm going to ask as I go on with the presentation. Okay, so as I mentioned before, a big target when it comes to research and what we're looking at is a focus, a shift of the focus, going from clinical diagnosis and treatment to early targeted interventions, and before the patients have significant symptoms. And for these strategies to be optimally effective and successful, it's critical to accurately identify and target who is at risk. That's why this becomes important, okay? So now this is, so some of this has been bad news. I've told you a lot of bad news. We haven't had a lot of progression in the last 15 years. A lot of these novel treatments, great in mice, great in animal studies, not so good in dementia studies. We haven't had good outcomes, right? So what's next? Well, there's a study, it's called the Generation Study Alzheimer Prevention Initiative. And at the University of Miami, we're going to have the Memory Disorder Center is going to have the only site for this study in South Florida. It's a worldwide study. It's run by Novartis through the Banner Institute with a geriatric psychiatrist, my friend and colleague, Dr. Pierre Tarriot. So what is this study? This is a study looking at people between the ages of 60 and 70 who have a relative with Alzheimer's disease. So they have a mother who had Alzheimer's, a father, a brother, a sister, a close relative, and they have that 10-time increased risk because they're homozygote positive for APOE4, so they're high risk to develop, and they're completely normal. There's nothing wrong with them. They don't even have MCI, nothing. They're completely normal. And we're going to enter them, if they meet the criteria, they'll be entered into a prevention trial in which they will be randomized to one of these treatments to reduce beta amyloid in their brain, either through immunotherapy or something called a BACE1 inhibitor, beta secretase inhibitor. And the trial is a long trial. Most drug trials are 8 to 12 weeks. This is a 5-year trial. Okay, so this is a landmark study. There's never been anything tried like this before. This is before anyone has symptoms. They just have the risk that you talked about. And we're going to start this study has already started randomizing and screening subjects through multiple sites. We'll be up and running probably by Christmas. So it's a very interesting study. I want to talk to you now, I want to shift focus, I want to talk to you about the Memory Disorder Clinic, okay? The Memory Disorder Clinic at the University of Miami has been around for many, many years. It's gone through a number of transitions. It's state-funded. There are 15 state-funded. It was one of the first throughout the state of Florida. And I've been running the Memory Disorder Clinic for a number of years now. I think it's like 6 or 7 years. So what do we provide? Well, we provide a number of things. The first thing we provide is state-of-the-art comprehensive memory and cognitive evaluations across multiple disciplines, okay? I'm a geriatric psychiatrist, but I'm also a cognitive expert in diagnosing these disorders, okay? But we work with neuropsychologists and neurologists also in helping people. Whether it be somebody who brings to me their loved one who already has Alzheimer's disease and has been diagnosed and needs me to help them, to manage them, versus somebody who has Alzheimer's in their family and is just starting to have memory loss and wants to come in for an evaluation by an expert, we see all these types of patients. And so, and that's what we, that's from the clinical perspective what we do. Additionally, a large part of our mission and what we do is education, okay? So when it comes to the University of Miami, I educate all the medical students, okay? All the residents in psychiatry, neurology, about Alzheimer's disease and cognition. But we also educate professionals in the community, social work, nursing. We educate and offer multiple community outreaches to both paid and unpaid caregivers, both all through South Florida in Miami-Dade and Monroe County. We also provide memory screenings and community outreach for clinical care as well as research. And we have tons of caregiver support opportunities. The Memory Disorder Clinic is warehoused within the Center on Aging, which is Director Dr. Sarah Saja, who is a world expert on caregiving and helping caregivers of patients who have dementia and Alzheimer's disease. We provide support groups and also individual counseling and therapy for many of our caregivers. We also educate about silver alerts. How many people have heard of what knows what a silver alert is? Silver alerts, good, so a lot of people. So silver alerts are these alerts that you see on the highway, which are elderly persons who may or may not be cognitively impaired, who maybe drove off in a car and the loved one is concerned that they're gonna get lost or something bad's gonna happen to them, right? So one of the things we do as a memory disorder is we educate all of the police officers throughout Miami-Dade and Monroe County about what a silver alert is and how to manage these, and we take and give a referral to us at the Memory Disorder Center. So I just want to mention about clinical, we do a lot of clinical trial work with patients who already have Alzheimer's disease in the Memory Disorder Clinic. And in order for me to tell you a little bit about the type of clinical trial, I have to talk to you about being a psychiatrist, okay? So let me tell you a quick story about being a psychiatrist. So I went to medical school. I always wanted to be a doctor. I went to medical school to be a psychiatrist. I wanted to be a psychiatrist since I was a teenager. But for most of those years, I literally thought that I was going to be a psychoanalyst on the Upper East Side. That's what I thought I was going to do. That's really what I thought I was going to do. So how did I go from that to Alzheimer's? Well, that's a whole long story. So maybe afterwards, as we're talking, I can tell you a little bit about that. But the reason I'm telling you this story is that, so what does it mean to be a psychiatrist and take care of Alzheimer's disease? Well, Alzheimer's disease was always considered a psychiatric illness. When it was first case was seen by Alzheimer's in 1899, it was considered. It's only been in the last 20 years it's thought of more as a neurological condition because we know so much about it in the brain disorder. But the reality is that it's not just about memory loss, disorientation. It's about these things. It's about psychosis, depression, agitation, violence. Look at the numbers of patients, okay? This is probably the number one reason why loved ones bring their patients to me to manage this, because it's difficult to manage. And there's no FDA-indicated treatment for these kinds of things, okay? And the medicines we have to use are often awful. They're sedatives, and they can even increase the patient's likelihood of getting worse and dying. That's why people come to me as the expert rather than going to a primary care. I'm going to go quickly so we can end. I do have a number of clinical trials available to me in which we're trying to look at much safer ways to help patients with Alzheimer's disease who have severe agitation, psychosis, hallucinations, which is often the most debilitating symptoms that the caregiver has to deal with and can be very, very important. It's not a cure for the disease, but very, very important. So I do want to just mention that to you, that we do have that available. I also want to just give a huge shout out to the Center on Aging. I talked mostly about Alzheimer's disease, and I talked about the Memory Disorder Clinic, but we are part of the Center on Aging with Dr. Sarah Saja as our medical director. She has a ton of research opportunities for aging issues, for caregiver issues, in addition to Alzheimer's disease and dementia work. And so it's important because it's nice for me to have this large audience that I can talk to, because we're always looking for research subjects to come and participate and try to advance our knowledge of aging. One particular study, and this is pretty much my last slide, I just would, rather than going through, a new study we got, what's called a dual target study. If you have Alzheimer's disease, you have a caregiver. It's often like treating two people. You got to help the caregiver too, as much as you have to help the patient. Well, this new study we have enlists a dual target in which not only do we have interventions for the Alzheimer's patients or the dementia patients, we also have interventions for the caregiver to help them, hoping that the two dual targets helping both will have a better outcome. So what can we do when it comes to memory? Seek out evaluation and management in a specialty clinic like I run. Get involved in the local community initiatives. Participate in scientific studies and some of the clinical trials. I am going to tell you we have screening going on outside. I have Dr. Dolores Perdomo and Lena Garcia. They can answer any and all questions about the Memory Disorder Clinic. They're going to stay here for a while. Any of the research, any of the clinical, any of the education pieces. And then Adrienne Jarrett will be here with her, with the team from the Center on Aging, talking about all the resources we have there, including research. Thank you so much, everybody. Thank you. I want to answer questions. Thank you. Sorry. Yeah. So do you want to pass that around? Mm-hmm. Yeah. So I would love to hear from you guys. That's my favorite part. You see her over there? Oh. Okay.
What have you heard about the fish oil stuff?
With the fish oil stuff? Well, you know, I'm going to make it even broader. So in general, as we age, what's good for your heart is good for your head. So anything you know that's good for good heart health, diet, exercise, antioxidants, taking an aspirin once a day, right? Fish oils, it's going to be good for your head. So it's probably recommended. It's not going to reverse it once you have it, but it's a good thing.
What do you think about lemosity?
Hold on.
On
what? What is Predigen? So I'm going to repeat what I said. Of everything we've looked at, including amyloid-lowering agents that work beautifully on mice, nothing has slowed the progression, nothing, the way we want it to, except for the FDA-indicated drugs, nothing. So it's a lot of charlatanism out there.
What is the FDA doing?
The ones that I told you, Aricept, right? Don't worry, hopefully I'm gonna get all these slides to everybody. That'll help.
I think I read in the Farmer's Almanac that a good remedy for forgetfulness is alcohol.
That's good. Yeah.
I find myself every time I forget. Yeah. Taking a shot of whiskey.
Yeah.
So I'm encouraged more and more to forget. And I was wondering what the relationship of...
That is awesome. I love it. That's a great one. So I'm going to talk to you from a perspective not of a researcher, as a clinician here, because it's important for you guys to hear. If you were to ask me, when those people come in with memory loss, that early phases, what is the three most common things that I see that is causing worsening of memory loss that you can actually fix, lack of sleep, you know, people have sleep apnea, because we didn't talk about that, people, you know, so they need to sleep, right? Number two, prescription drugs. So they're taking too many prescription drugs that may be sedatives or have certain things in them that are causing memory loss, and alcohol, you know. So not alcohol in moderation, but people who drink a lot of alcohol, right, on a regular basis, the good news of it is when you have cognitive problems from it, most of the time if you stop drinking, it gets better. The problem is trying to get people to start drinking, right? Oh, okay, let's leave it there. Yeah. Anybody leave a cell phone?
How is the progression from senior moment to Alzheimer's and dementia? And what do you think about lumosity?
This is a great question that I think I got to answer well. So in the old, he wants to know, how do you know whether or not it's just a senior moment or it's like Alzheimer's? And what do I think of luminosity? So that's a hard question. And in the old days, not that long ago, in the old days, the idea was you went to your doctor, you said, doctor, you know, I'm having these senior moments, I'm worried. My mother had Alzheimer's. Most doctors to this day will still say to you, you know what, Alzheimer's patients, they don't know that they have memory loss. Just the fact that you know that, you're fine. They'll tell you that. Right? That's not true. And so my recommendation is if you have a family history and it's happening frequently, very frequently, you should be evaluated. Does that make sense? It's a lot about the frequency of how common it happens. That's a huge part of it. And when it starts to affect your life, that's really when you start to worry, especially if you have family history or risk factors. Luminosity, I'm not usually politically correct, so I have to be. So I'm here to tell, remember how I told you about violent video games? They're better for cognition than luminosity. They are, absolutely.
Why?
Because they're much better at helping elderly people with the cognitive problems that most affect them. Yes. I'm not recommending that you go ahead and start doing that, but we, you know, I think that luminosity is good for you to get your brain going, but I think if you're really worried, you should consider looking at more evidence stuff like our brain fitness program, which is a little bit more state of the art, and we have that here, and you can learn about it. Yes, sir. I think I said that already. From the time you're diagnosed till death is usually 11 years on average. She's running around.
Hi. I just wondered if you could address 2 things. First, the sleep apnea, I heard earlier that 50% of people have dementia are also people who suffer from sleep apnea. And also the effect of Benadryl, there have been several studies about how Benadryl affects or promotes dementia.
So there are a whole host, that's a whole other lecture in terms of the Benadryl story. There are a whole host of medicines. And if you invite me back, I'll be happy to talk about that. That can make memory worse and make dementia worse. Benadryl just happens to be one of them. There are many of them. When it comes to sleep and apnea, okay, the bottom line is we need to sleep cognitively. We need to sleep for our health. It's bad for our heart, it's bad for our head, and we now recognize that not sleeping, a good night's sleep, is very detrimental to our body and our brains. And so when you have sleep apnea and you're waking hundreds of times a day, you're basically sleep deprived. So it's whether you're demented or not, it's good to get an evaluation and get treatment for it.
Does it help to take a sleeping drug at night?
No. That's a whole other talk. It's a big risk factor for Alzheimer's. There are many risk factors I didn't talk too much about because I didn't have time. Brain trauma, repeated concussions, that's a huge risk factor. Depression at a young age is a huge risk factor also. Yeah, that's a big risk factor for Alzheimer's disease.
What is? What's a big risk factor?
Head trauma.
Since you're stating that this is going to become a much bigger problem,
yes,
as time goes on, how are you going to have enough trained people to deal with this problem?
That's a great question.
Also, I've heard that if you exercise, it helps your heart, it helps your brain.
Yes, yeah. I don't know if you guys are well-versed in good health. The amount we're supposed to exercise keeps creeping up, right? It used to be like 3 hours moderate exercise. It goes up and up. Now they want intense exercise for many hours, right? So, yes, exercise is great for you. Great for you.
Did I do that?
No.
Great.
Well, now the recommendation is 4 hours of intense exercise, not just moderate exercise. But I want to get back to your first question, which is a great question. How are we going to train all these people? We're not. So I used to have slides not that long ago that talked about the shortage of geriatricians in psychiatry, primary care, everywhere. There's absolutely no way we're going to have enough specialists in geriatrics to treat all these, it's just not gonna happen. And the federal government recognizes this. So the idea is, hopefully, that as we develop these tests, that every clinician is gonna have to be trained in what I call cognitive health. My colleague, Dr. David Lowenstein, who I talked about with early Alzheimer's, he calls it the cognitive stress test. So he talks about the fact, like when you go to your cardiologist, you go to your primary care, they do an EKG. Everybody knows this. It really doesn't tell you much, right? What you gotta do is what? You gotta have a stress test because your heart has to be stressed. And once you have a stress test, that tells you much better how your heart is functioning. It's the same with cognition. So if you just do the basic screen of cognition, that doesn't really tell you much. You have to undergo a cognitive stress test, which I'm hoping that every clinician is gonna have to be well-versed in. And that's really the focus for probably for the next 10 to 15 years.
I have a question. Is Lewy body dementia, is that hereditary?
That's a good question. Not as much as Alzheimer's disease, but yes, it can. It's a variant of Parkinson's disease.
Right.
So you often see Parkinson's disease can be inherited.
But it could be hereditary.
Yes.
And there's a fine line between ADD and dementia.
ADD?
Right, ADHD, attention deficit disorder.
Is there a link between the two? Not that I'm aware of, no. No. More depression and anxiety, yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Thank you.
We've got a lot of people here. You gotta be quicker. Yes, unfortunately, yes. Primary relative, a brother, a sister, mother, a father, absolutely yes.
Hold on.
I gotta do this one. I didn't hear the question.
If you suspect that someone has declining memory, what does the evaluation consist of?
That's a great question too. So there's two parts to the evaluation in the Memory Disorder Center. The first part is getting a good history from both the patient and the informant, meaning the loved one. So we can't do the evaluation without the loved one to give us objective data, you know, what they are witnessing. And then the patient undergoes a cognitive battery, a brief cognitive, it takes about an hour, that we go over. And then once I get this data in the first evaluation, we come to a conclusion of what other tests we think are necessary, whether that be an MRI, blood work, or other tests. And I usually I need both the caregiver or the informant, the loved one, and the patient there. So, and it takes about 2 hours, the first evaluation. Absolutely. Well, you're going to see lots of cards out there.
Question, if you haven't got it by the time you're 84, are the odds you're not going to get
no.
it, or are you going to get
you
it?
Can get it. So you can still get it, yes.
Not. Once you get the early evaluation.
Hello. Oh, hold on. Yes. Yes, sir.
I'm sorry,
say it again.
Rest.
Oh, well, everybody's a little different. Everybody's a little different. You know, some people need 8 hours sleep, some people need six, but most people say 7 to 8 hours of sleep.
12.
How do you treat those who have undergone a tremendous amount of chemo, what they call chemo brain? What do you do about that?
That's a good question. So that's a little bit different. That's a little bit different than the neurodegenerative diseases that I treat. You know, usually my colleagues in oncology treat those patients, although there are times when there are certain patients who are cancer survivors, cancer patients, there are certain treatments that they get that do put them at a greater risk for Alzheimer's. Most commonly is radiation to the brain. I might as well tell you. So my mother, today's my mother's 74th birthday. I'm going to tell you guys. So she had small cell cancer of the lung when she was 59. That means her 5-year survival rate was 7%. She had massive chemo and radiation, and it cured her. It cured her. So she's 74. Today's her birthday. She forgot my birthday because why? Because she has early Alzheimer's now. But you know what? The risk was worth it. Because we got her, you know, for all these more years. I'm going to tell, so it's just weird. I'm telling you the truth.
What is the meaning of pseudo-dementia?
Oh, I have a whole slide. Again, these are all great questions, other hours of talk. Pseudo-dementia was coined in the 60s. The idea was when a person had severe clinical depression, severe, right? That oftentimes, especially if they were over 50, they could look like they were demented. They could look like they were demented. The reality is that most of those patients that do have that level of depression and they typically do have dementia also, unfortunately. It's a bit of a misnomer.
I recently read about some studies that are looking at immunological reaction to viral infections in the brain as being a possible cause of Alzheimer's.
Yes.
Can you comment about that?
Yes. So, you know, I'm at the clinical level, and I'm at the level of people helping them on a day-to-day basis. So, yes, I've heard about this. I've read about this. There have been some promise to this, definitely. But unfortunately, there's been a lot of promise to many things that just don't pan out. That's at that end, I'm at this end. I'm at the, you know, show me the money. I wanna see the progression stop. So that's why I'm showing you the much more kind of negative view, and that we have to look at people before they develop the disease. But yes, this is another promising idea that hopefully will pan out and will be looked at.
Can we take one more question over here? And then we're going to cut it off. But Dr. Crocco, I think, and her folks are going to stick around. To
yeah, no, we're going to be here.
So there'll be plenty
yeah,
of
there's many, questions. Many questions.
Hi, Dr. Crocco. Thank you. Wonderful. We have Alzheimer's very close in our family. So I'm going to ask you something that you covered, but I want to make sure.
Talking to the microphone.
Yes.
What about it later in life?
Both. So, yes,
now,
both.
The only thing is, you mentioned there the vitamin B and E. I've read also that folic acid with vitamin B, 6 and 12,
yeah.
And
yeah.
B,
Yeah, and the concept being the antioxidants in general. But there is something I want to talk about antioxidants. In the old days, 15 years ago, 20 years ago, everybody wanted antioxidants, antioxidants, antioxidants. We used 2,000 IUs of vitamin E a day. This is dangerous. We now know this is dangerous. You do not want to take too many vitamins. It's not good for you. It's particularly been shown in women to increase their risk of heart disease. So you got to be careful. You have to, everything in moderation. But yes, antioxidants can be good for you. Okay?
All right, so let's thank Dr. Crocco.
Thank you.
I'll give you one piece of parting advice, okay? As you go and take the memory test and so forth. Years ago when I was dealing with my dad, new job, a lot of stress and so forth, I was having a hard time concentrating, right? I got up in the middle of the night one night, took out my computer and decided I was gonna take one of these memory tests online. It's one of those deals where you see an image and you hit the button or you don't hit the button. I go through this, I hit the thing that total it up, I fail miserably. But at this point, the sweat is pouring down my brow. I'm trying to figure out how to get my things in order and so forth. And then I went back and read the instructions. And the instruction says, if you saw the image before, hit this button. If you didn't see the image before, hit this other button. I only answered half the questions. Thanks, God. Thank God. So if you decide to play around with any of these tests on the computer, make sure you read the instructions. Follow the directions. Dr. Crocco, thank you so much.